Now my world was easy, I began to think to myself, because Baba said to just obey me and that if I did that, he would show me God. And of course that was all that I wanted. And so I promised him that I would do whatever he asked me to do. Baba told me, from now on, keep silent. And if you need to talk to anyone, just come back to me and talk to me. So from then on, I began my silence. But occasionally, a hello to a teacher would escape. And because, you know, I was a young child, I didn't have the faculties to focus properly and to concentrate on observing silence. So once in a while, I would accidentally say hello to somebody. And on those occasions, I would go down the hill to Baba, and Baba would ask me to talk to him. Sometimes I would sit with him for about an hour or so, and Baba would be doing his work, and occasionally he would gesture to me something or other. And I forgot to say that when we got off the carriage and Baba Mirabad here, Baba told me that from now on, you should think of me as your God, as your father, as your mother, as your relatives, as your friends, as your sister and brother, as your everything. From now on, I am your everything. Just think of me and think of nothing, no one else. Thinking about Baba gradually became like an addiction for me. And just like when you're addicted to a cigarette, you have to have your cigarette. When it was time for me to meditate, I just had to go and meditate. And that made me so happy and so content. This continued for some time. But then there came a time when negative thoughts started to bombard me. And these thoughts would not leave me alone. And I had no control over them. They would not let me meditate or think about Baba. And it was like two strong wrestlers were fighting the thoughts on one hand and me on the other. And this fight was going on inside of me and continued for about 5 to 6 months. Of course, Baba knew what was going on inside me. And finally, one day, Baba called me to hall number 1 at 11 o'clock, which is now the museum. And he asked me what I was thinking. I could not tell him my evil thoughts. I was too embarrassed. I was too ashamed. My thoughts on their own would start insulting Baba. I couldn't tell him that. For about half an hour, Baba tried to get me to say my thoughts, but I was too ashamed to say them. And finally, he took out his alphabet board and began to spell out my thoughts. I could follow the words and read what he was spelling out, and I saw that Baba was spelling out all my thoughts exactly. And then he asked me, "Did you understand?" Still I said, "No." Then Baba said, "Yes, you understood it perfectly." Then he took his alphabet board and left the room. Still I did not have control over my thoughts. Things got just a little bit better, but not much. And I still could not meditate properly on Baba. Now, there was a rule that if any of the students misbehaved or disobeyed an order, they would be just simply returned to their parents. So I thought to them, I should disobey. Then I would be sent away, and then I would be out of here and out in the outside world, and perhaps over there my mind would settle down, and after it settled down, maybe I could return. So I disobeyed an order. Prabhupada asked me to get up and sit somewhere else, and I disobeyed. I said no. So he immediately told Baba, and Baba came to me and he said, do you want to return to your parents? And I said yes. And then Baba asked Prabhupada to go and pack my luggage and to bring it there. So Prabhupada went and he packed my belongings and brought it. But then as soon as I saw him bringing the chest, I felt like a shock went through my body. And I was very nervous and upset. Then Bhagavad told Baba that yes, his belongings are ready, and then he asked me to go and take Baba's darshan so that we could leave. Now, I could not move my legs. My legs were senseless, they were paralyzed. They were lifeless. I would stick my nails in my legs to bring some sensation, but I couldn't feel anything. My legs were asleep, as sometimes happens when you know, circulation slows down. It was not like that. My legs felt as if they were dead. So I couldn't get up. At that time, Baba signaled to Bhagavan to take me. So Bhagavan picked me up and took me to Baba. Baba put his arm around me and said, well, don't you want to go to your parents? Don't you want to leave? At that time I said, no. So he embraced me and said that, it's all right, you can stay, I forgive you. So I stood up and my legs were completely cured. I could walk perfectly. Still, for a few more months, these bad thoughts persisted in a milder form. And they still interfered with my meditation and would not let me think properly, deeply, from the depths of my heart about love. As I was struggling to work and thinking about Baba, different ways of working inside myself would present themselves and I would follow them. One or two times Baba told me to continue the way that I was thinking and working within myself. Then gradually got to the point that no stray thoughts could penetrate my mind. It was as if I was inside my own house and no unwanted thoughts could enter that house.
I'm going to go back a little bit just to give an introduction of how Babel, you know, collected the kids and brought them to Mera God. But in the meantime, you know, if any question comes up, please ask me because that could jog my memory. To other things that we can talk about. Daniel had come to India in search of a better master. He was in search of the truth. And I don't know exactly the details of his meeting Baba, but one of the mandalas kind of encountered him and said, you know, let's go, we meet Mera Baba. And that was late 1919 or early 1920s. Because when he met Baba, Baba said he was engaged to his later wife, or his wife, Sotu. And Baba told him, you go back to Iran, marry your fiancé, and then be there when I will call you when I need. So he goes back under. Baba's over, he goes back, he gets married. He has a house in Yaz and Jaffa as well, which still actually exists as a center where Baba later visited that house in 1931. He starts teaching at the school, local school there, but what happens in the meantime, he starts holding meetings about Baba, which the neighboring community and their relatives would go. And his father says he was 5 years old, and he would grab his mom's garment, basically going to David's house and looking at the photos on the wall of Baba. And Baba would talk about how beautiful Baba's voice was, and the singing and all that. As a child, he was attracted to Baba, but not knowing who really Baba was. Even until he comes to Pramesha, he didn't know who really Baba was. But in later years, in early 1926 or so, Baba wanted to start the school. So he sends a message to Bagel that, you know, I want some kids, you know, some kids who don't have enough money to come and, you know, for free education, free clothing, free food and all that, you know, expenses paid, basically. About some of the kids, Bagel contacted the family, knew the kids. I think he went from some of the villages, looking at the families and, you know, seeing who could fit into the category of all ones. I could say my relatives, my uncles were those type of category, because they couldn't probably read the magazine, but for a standard, it was a little different. There was a local magazine called Ashram-ite. And Esfandiar reads the article that Baba is offering free schooling. And he knew about Baba. He said, oh, this is a great school. I have to go to India. And by the way, Edud was Esfandiar's mother's uncle. So they had that relation. And then when he sees that article, he comes and tells his mom that, you know, I'm not going to school anymore. His school was in Kwaramsha. So he comes back to Jafarabad, which was his village. And Bagel's house is right next to actually Sandra's house. And he says, you know, I'm not going to go to school until I go to Maryland school, basically. Either that or nothing. And the mom said, you know, he wanted him to go. But the father was very much against that. And he said, no, my son, I can't let my son go away from my eyes. You know, basically in a foreign country, strange place, what's going to happen to you? You know how the father, you know, even I did that too. Eventually, you know, the father agreed, because the mother said so much that, you know, this is Mayor Baba, that my uncle talks about him so much, he's a spiritual master. He agrees, and then Bagel in the meantime had collected other kids. There were 14 of them all together. I remember some of the names that I can say, because the Sangha also talks about them later. One was Shapur Mirgadi, who actually was coming to the meetings in Iran. Then Hassan Dilak, who was from Yaz, who was Muslim. I think there were two of them Muslim and 12 Zoroastrians. Esfandiar, Vesali, Khosrow, and Khudriyar, and Iranian. there was one person named Baron, and there were a few others too, but Abba Ali, who we read about himself in the drugs, he came actually from Bombay. His father and family were living in Bombay, and he came from Bombay. Chota Baba after the Pakram, he also had traveled from Bandar Abbas by himself in search of God, finding his way to India and basically coming in contact with God. So when the 14 gets together, they come and Bhairav brings them to Bandar. It's a port called Bushan, and from there with a ship. Now there are a lot of small little details around the story, but anyway, he brings them all to Maryland. They get off the train at the station and they rent one of these bullet carts. And the bullet cart starts going with the luggage and all of them on the top of the car. But it was so bumpy that Esfandiar said, "My given God's will, throwing out, so I couldn't stay on there." I decided just to jump off and run after the car. And as I did that, other kids followed, so we all followed the car. All the way to Maraba, right here. We came. Bhairav group them around behind the old Dharamsala. We put them in a row just to wait there behind the Dharamsala. Baba's office was the room that you can see right next to the hall. So Bhairav was waiting for Baba to come and greet the boys basically. Now, as somebody comes out of the compound, the Esfandiar Siddhartha is looking to see if this is Mary Baba, because he had seen this picture. So he said, I was paying attention to who that was. He said, no, that it wasn't part of the mandir. Finally, Baba appears, and he goes to the front of the line. Starts giving the voice. Karasi, there's a voice. That'll come in. That's it. Until he gets to his finger. As soon as he was the oldest and tallest of the back of the mountain. So as soon as he gets to his finger, Baba doesn't pay attention to his finger, but he kisses his feet, and Baba puts his feet and walks away. This was so hard on him. And he said, "What is sinner I must be? That man will give him a way for you to kiss his feet." But, we have come basically to study to be a good student, become a doctor or an engineer or something. And he decided to hang around and see what Baba wants. And he said it took about a couple of weeks for them to get their books, their uniform, and also the classroom set up and teacher and all that for them to go to school. He remembers he was the only student in his class, and the class was held at Dharamsala, facing the upper Narabad basically. So he was facing the upper Narabad, and Rao Sahib, Kehoshwarasari, was his teacher. A few days passes, and he goes through some of the class homework and all that. But it doesn't take too long until Rao Sahib starts reciting a couplet from Sarin. He says, رسد آدمی به جایی که به جز خدا نمیدن. ببینید که تا چه حد است مقام ما. He says, man can get to a point that does not see anything except God. So see how high the abode of human being is. When that covenant was read to him, it triggered something in him that he said, Can really man become God? He starts asking the teacher, and Rav Sahib, that question. And Rav Sahib says, the whole purpose of this creation is for man to become God. And then he starts reciting some more couplets of his and Rumi and kind of gets to the point that the Esfandiar thinks to himself, you know, that if the purpose of life is to become God, what am I doing here? Why am I going to school to study to become a doctor or an engineer? I want to live, I'm God. So, you know, but this in his mind, he was looking, you know, at through the sky, looking for God as a child, not knowing where God is. And wouldn't pay attention to school work anymore. Until one of those days, you know, Rao said, I talked to Baba, but this time there was not paying attention in the school work. So Baba comes. The Esfandiar said, I was sitting there and suddenly I noticed that Rav Sahib, you know, was bowing down. And I looked back and I saw Baba right behind me. And I suddenly got up to, you know, greet him and kiss his feet. Baba held me and, you know, kind of held me in his hand. And then he said, tell me, why don't you study? I heard that you're not studying. Why don't you study? He said, oh, I can't study. I don't, you know, I can't study. He said, no, tell me, why don't you study? Are you homesick? Do you want to go to your parents? Do you want to go back to your mom? You know, I was questioning him. I said, oh, Baba, no. But then Baba said, why don't you study? He said, you can't go. Finally, Baba said, okay, if you don't tell me why you don't study, I'll send you to your uncle. He had an uncle in Bombay. Your uncle in Bombay. Now, in this time, Esfandiar's thoughts were, I want to find God. And here, I can't. Because of the rules and regulations of the school, I won't be able to find anything. I'm going to run off to the woods and then try to find God in the forest, in the woods. And then Baba said, I'll send you to your uncle. Sandor said, oh, that would be good, you know, if you send me to Anika, I can run away. And then Baba, all knowing, he said, no, I will send it to your parents in Iran. Then he thinks, oh my God, if I go back to my parents in Iran, you know, then my father wants me to, you know, help him in the farming, you know, all that, and then eventually he's going to get me married with someone. And that's the end of my searching for God. So then he said, then he tells Baba that, Baba, I want to see God. And as soon as he says, I want to see God, Baba just embraces him, holds him for a while, and the Esfandiar said, that embrace cleared up and was more than the time that you left me, you know, that you basically Baba, you know, and greet me, welcome me, you know. It was so pleasant. And then Baba tells him, come, follow me. And the Esfandiar follows Baba through the Dharamsara, through the Dharamsara into the back room, into the side room. In that side room, he said it was Baba's place of rest, office basically. And his God, he was there. And then, Esfandiar, you know, tells Baba tells Esfandiar, sit on the throat. So Esfandiar is sitting on the throat, Baba is lying down on the gari, and then Baba covers himself with a sheet. With a sheet, and Esfandiar explains that when Baba, before Baba went under the sheet, he was, you know, rosy and beaming of light. But when he came out, he was very pale and coming out of the sickness. And I remember asking, why was that? And he said, I think Baba was taking basically an all by some scars to clean me up, to get me ready for what comes next. And what comes next is interesting, because Baba comes up to Shiva and tells Esfandiar to follow him. They come through another door to the back side of the building, facing upper level. And here he sees that the chariot is ready. For those who have been in the museum, that chariot in the museum is the one. It's a small rickshaw. And that's pulled by, you know, see pictures that is pulled by either the Pramashram boys or the Mandals. But at the time, there were two Mandals who were pulling, maybe to pull Baba. Baba instructed them to be ready for it. So then he comes, Baba goes up on the rickshaw and tells the sender to go up. Now, if you have seen that the sitting place is only pretty much for one person. So Esfandiar said, then Baba went up the rickshaw and I went up. There was no place for me to sit. And I was standing right in front of Baba. And then, you know, the monkeys started pulling. And the rickshaw pulled into Haragam village. I'm pretty sure there was a train station. And from there, all the way up the hill. And it was so bumpy, he said that he was about to fall, and Baba said, hold on to my arms. So we have, you know, Baba's arm all the way up the hill until they get up the hill close to the museum, the water tank at that time. And then Baba tells him to get up. So he gets up. Baba gets up to rickshaw. And then Baba, see how compassionate he is. And how we could clean ourselves, all of us. This is an example, one day example. And he says, did you see how bumpy the road was? And he says, yes, Baba. He says, that is exactly how the spiritual path is. It's full of bumps. Then Baba tells him, if you hadn't held up to my arm, what would have happened? And he says, Baba, I would have fallen off. He says, that is exactly how the spiritual path is. If you don't hold on to me, you will fall off. So you want to see God? He says, yes, Baba. He says, I will show you God, but you have to obey me implicitly. And then he says, from now on, you keep silence. From now on, I am your father, your mother, your brother, your sister, your relatives, all of the ones you know, your friends, it's me. You focus only on me and nothing else. So that is said to me is that when you are focused, when you are one pointed on Baba, he definitely pulls us through all these bumps of the road. And from then on, you know, he was the first Pramashal boy. And Baba called that Prem Ashram because later other boys joined him in Prem Ashram. And, he was keeping silence. He said, "My work," we asked him, what were you doing for the whole day, He said, the whole day and night was basically thinking about him. If he had some nature call, he would go to the nature call. If he had, if he had to have food, he would ring the bell and go eat something. He would get thirsty, would drink, like a normal person. But in the meantime, he would sit in nature remembrance. He would close our eyes. And imagine within our heart, that's how Baba had told him. So imagine within their heart. And love, and they were basically practicing this cultivation of love. And to the extent possible. And he said, sometimes I didn't have any night. Night was not meaning to me, days was not meaningful to me. I would think of him until the body would get tired. Then I would come off, go for a walk. Or when Baba would come and play, sometimes we would go up there with Baba. But, it kept going like that. One day, Baba would come there, the sleeping quarter was the hall behind the museum, the East Room. And from the way he described, Baba had divided that East Room to the hallway with a lot of cubicles on either side. And this cubicle was somewhere in the middle. And he said, we would sit in his remembrance, and Baba would come in the middle of the night. Putting his hand over his head, and sometimes Baba would just tell me about his experiences, and he would say a little bit of it, and say, "That's enough." And he would go, and then he would guide him, sometimes inwardly, sometimes outwardly, Baba would tell him what to do. So it kept on going until Baba started discoursing, and that was the time that Chota Baba had come and joined Baba, and Baba had raised him to the sixth plane of consciousness. But Baba was talking about Chota Baba, that his previous life, he was on the second plane of consciousness, and he was loving God in an extent that his heart stops, because that love was so overwhelming that kills him, basically. So Baba was warning them, that if the love becomes too intensified, and you want to let it go, because that might be a hazard to your body. So the Esfandiar says that was right before he had that experience, because he went into some kind of a remembrance and inner communion with Baba, that he said the love became so much that he felt his heart is going to stop right there. And then he suddenly remembered what Baba said about Chota Baba. So he stopped. He stopped loving what he was doing. Basically, he came off the room and went for a walk just to cool off and come back and start working again. He said, that didn't happen anymore. But through that, a lot of experiences came. You would see night and stars coming out of him. He would experience being in a rose garden, or a lot of fragrance that he would say. He would close his sometimes nose, and because he would hear the melody. That's when he plugged his ear, see if that is the same coming from outside. He would test on that. And he would, then he would realize that this is inner experience, not outer experience. I'm going to stop here and let Shaheen maybe bring up a few things. Then if you have any questions, and I don't know how there will be time, and I can go on and on. Okay.
Take over the room. I would like to share some of my stories with Esfandiar, and also some of this experience is very personal. But regarding that story that Parshi said about Chota Baba, I heard that Esfandiar told me when Chota Baba in previous life he had a heart attack, because his master wasn't perfect at that time, at his previous life. And so he, in the spiritual path, there are so many experiences and they are very dangerous. And if the master were not there or not perfect, it's very dangerous for aspirant to continue. And it may trap and die in those very strong experiences. And this man here says, same thing happened to me when I was in Iran. And I was doing my my work and meditating on Baba and loving my Baba. But what happened when I closed my eyes and I felt I am going to the ocean of bliss. And this was so powerful that this was filling up in my body. And gradually my heart started beating very fast. And then I remember what Baba said about Abdullah Baba, that he had a heart attack. So some of the experiences very dangerous. That's important to follow the good master and God. Esfandiar emphasized on the heart, or dil. The dil means in Farsi, house of God, or the place that person can love the beloved. In Persian literature, most of the poets, they use that word, dil. Dil means house of beloved. And this time you emphasize that very lot about how to love and have our God in your heart. When I was a child, I want to explain what that means for me, how I learned. When I was a child, I raised in Zoroastrian family. So I was going to the choir temple and seeing all the Zoroastrian worshipping in front of the fire. And it was a question why Zoroaster told all the people to, he brought the fire in his hand and he told all the people to burn this fire all the time in the temple and worship our master. What that means. And Muslim would told me that you are a fire worshipper, come to Islam. And I couldn't explain why, what that means. This man you explained to me about the fire and what Zoroaster said. The fire that he brought as a symbol of love for God, that fire is pure and purifying, love for God. And our heart is a temple, and that fire should be burned all the time in our heart. And it would burn, and also Baba said, whatever you throw in the fire, that love, it burns. No matter good or bad, it will burn. So Esfandiar mentioned that and said, if that fire of love is not in your heart, no matter prayer, meditation, or no matter what you do, it doesn't have any meaning, doesn't have any value. That's why Zoroaster says people should burn that fire all the time in their heart, in the temple, and worship our master. So I learned to Esfandiar. I met him in Iran when I was 8 years old. Someone invited my parents and my family to go to Baba's meeting. And we went to Esfandiar's house at that time. I didn't know him. I saw him. And I saw Baba's photo on the movies, and I enjoyed it, but still I have this image in my mind. It was so great. And it took me, I wasn't ready at that time, it took me more like 19 years later, and my sister married my passion, and we went to this side George's house, so my relationship started with Esfandiar, and he was my first teacher. And regarding about when I was with Esfandiar, I was sometimes doing a watch as a watchman, being with him. He sometime one night he sat on the on his bed and he started crying. And I said to myself, I didn't say anything. I just thought to myself, why he's crying? He's so close to Baba and he loved Baba so much. But why he's crying? And he read my mind. He had that power to read my mind. And I was like a naked person in front of him. He knew about my action, daily life, and everything he knew, and he showed me that he knows everything about me. And he would correct me and say through the stories, he never said directly, you are doing this, it's not right, or you are doing this. He never said that. He was so polite and so sweet that he would say his advice through the stories, through the poems, and it was so, it touched my heart all the time. In that particular night, I said, why he's crying? And then he recited a Vesali of one of the poets. Said, Shamiyao daram ki chashmam nakho, Shaninam ki parvane basham ko, ki man aashiram gar besuzam ravas, Tura gerde usuz bari chiraz. Be gufta ki hava daram miskin man, Beraftan gari yari shiriri man, The roughly translation means, one night I couldn't sleep, and I heard the conversation between the moth and candle. Moth says, I'm a lover to the candle. I'm a lover, why you are crying, why you are burning and crying? And candle said, I'm crying because they made me the beeswax. They took honey away me. I'm crying because the sweetness from the honey. But you are not a true lover. You are afraid to be burned. You come close and you burn your wings. But look at me, I'm standing to burn the whole thing from head to toe. So that was his telling me that you are telling me that you are a lover, but you are not a lover, and you are afraid of burning. That's true. Sometimes you're scared of burning. So there are so many stories about the Esfandiar and so many things like that. One of the stories that I had with Esfandiar, when he was in Iran, one night he fell and he broke his hip. And he was in the very, very, very bad pain that somebody called me and I went there in his house and I saw him lying on the ground and I saw him. He was shouting his mother's name, Om Nemo. And so Ashram-ite said, Mother Nemo, all memo, and was just shouting. And the question came to my mind, why he's calling his mother? Mother is dead. And how his mother can help him? Why he doesn't call his father? So this question was in my mind. And then we went to the hospital and we spent some night with him in the hospital. And then one night I got a chance to ask this question. Esfandiar, that time you didn't call Mary Baba's help. Why did you call your mother? And Esfandiar told me, Mary Baba is not my help. I never called you for my worldly problems. I need him only for my spiritual path, for my path to see God. He's here to help me to find God. I never ask him for my daily problems, for worldly problems. And that was my answer to my question. It was amazing. And then later on, when he recovered, he was resting in his house. Sometime I was going and visiting, but at night he was by himself and his wife. One night, they were both sick and on the bed. His son said, he told me that he had a lot of pain. And his wife also sick in a lot of pain. And his wife was asking for some water or something. And his son couldn't go. And he couldn't go and get some water for his wife. And then he said to his son, what a situation, what a problem. And he said, crying, we are hopeless and helpless. And no one here to help us. So he was crying. And then he said, now I try to go to him, Baba. So he closed his eyes and tried to go to Baba and accept whatever it is. He surrendered himself as whatever it comes to him is his wish. And then he started loving him. And then he loved Baba so much that he felt that he gained infinite power. That he felt, he said, I felt I have infinite power, that I can heal myself, heal my wife, and change the whole situation, and everything will be good. And then he remembered that what Baba said about the fourth plane of infinite power. And then he decided not to do this kind of work, and misuse the power. And then he said, I use that power to love Mary Baba. And I love Mary Baba so much that I lost myself in Mary Baba. It wasn't me anymore. It was Baba, loving Mary Baba. And one of the poems said, Mantoshali. من تو شدم تو من شدی من تن شدم تو جان شدی تا کس نگوید بعد از این من دیگرم بودم. You became me, I became you. I became body and you become my soul. And now we are merging together and no one can see we are together. I feel I'm so fortunate that such a person like me, full of weakness and things, I met such a person like him, and he changed my life. I don't know how to tell about him. He was so great, he was so close to Allah, and he loved Allah so much. I don't know how that is about
me. Let's see if you have anybody has any questions maybe. And that would be something.
Anyone have any questions?
If anyone wants to hear anything of these that they missed, I mean, there are a lot of
sure, yes.
It's not really a question, but it's a memory I have of Esfandiar, long time ago when he had come back to Mehrabad. And I was new, I was a young new doctor. And early one morning I'm calling the Dharamshala, and he's having a terrible pain. And sent him to hospital, and the radiologist said he has stones in his gallbladder. And it's very bad, within 2 weeks or maximum 3 weeks, the gallbladder will be completely blocked, it will turn yellow, he should have surgery right now. So with the help of Twitter groups to translate, we explained the situation that he should go back to Iran after surgery. And Mr. Vesali listened and he smiled. He didn't seem worried or afraid. He said, I have come for Mehrabad's Amantiti. That was like 2 or 3 weeks away. I'm not going to go back to Iran. I'm staying. And I thought that's really a bad idea. So every morning he would come for breakfast, he was better, and I would look at him in yellow, and he would look at me, and he knew exactly that I was, what I was thinking, and he would nod and give me a big smile. And I kept, you know, he never turned yellow, he stayed all the time for my mother. And I felt that he was taking care of me, you know, such a Mr. Young doctor, you don't really know everything yet. But what I thought was so wonderful that he was not upset with me. He was just keep smiling and sending me this wonderful love that he sent me out. So that's my memory of meeting this one there.
Yeah, I remember I was in the hospital building also, and you know, trying to attend to some of his needs at the time. It was called the problem that he had. You know, he was so in those numbers of blood, sometimes it's a hard to understand in your mind. You have to go through your heart to understand. My sister was there too, and I told my sister, you know, but the Lord says that, you know, Swami called that stones are really bad, and, you know, it might be something that might kill him, and, you know, you need to go back, you need to go back, you don't have to go back. And, we talked to Swami, and he said, no, I'm here for a pilgrimage, even if I die, it doesn't matter. And, you know, Dr. Ram treated him with this encouragement. He was fine until the death. And I think in Iran, finally, like, and he said, you know, I'm going back to Iran, and I, you know, I need to go to do an operation of me to take care of
him. I remember, end of his life. Actually, they invited him to come to some of us in Los Angeles, California. And he came, and he spent like 10 years in the US. He lived in Los Angeles also for some time. And she reminded him what they took care of him. They asked him to come also join him and spend some time with him. And then later, he always would tell us that his time is coming. He wanted to go to his hometown and drop his body in the end, in his house, in Jafarabad. And one of the Ghazal authors, he always said that this is Hoffa's bill. This is من ارزان که گشتم به مسجد حلا به آیین مستان برای به تابوتی از چوب چاکم کنی، به راب خرابات خاکم کنی، راب خرابات خستم یعنی، حسانگاه بر دوش مستم یعنی، مریضی بر دور من جز شراب نیاری، در ماتمم جز زبان، بر یکم به شرطی که در مرد من ننامد، به جز مطرب و چنگ زنی، تو خود حافظا سرز مستی مطمئن، که سلطان
A rocky translation is impossible to translate all those poems in my broken language, I try not to say. Esfandiar that author says, when I die as beer drunk, do all the ceremonies customs between drunks. And he said, made my cast with a great wood or great trees, and wash my body in the water of the tower, and bury my body in the path that goes to the tower. Carry my body on the shoulder of the drums or masks. And do not pour anything in my grave except wine. Which is anyone comes to my grave, bring love and God, nothing else. And promise me, in my memorial day, nothing would cry except singer and musician. And then he says, O Hafiz, do not be hesitate to be a drunk all the time, because king cannot collect tax from the ruling peoples, which is must. And then when he left us and he went back to Jafarabad and in the Beyu's house, and Guha, Rashid's sister, took care of him until the end, and then she left. I was with Esfandiar, he was good for a few months, and then he decided not to eat solid food and only juice and water and soup, something like that. And I realized he knows his time is coming, and he didn't want to eat properly. He tried to serve him, but he didn't want. One night he was so skinny, and he was sitting on his bed whole night. With all this pain, and his bones was broken and all that, he was so much pain. One thing that I felt, when he goes to that state that loved Baba so much, that he didn't feel anything, he didn't feel any pain or anything, he was just totally disconnected from the whole world. And he was just with Baba. But when he comes back for water or food or something, or we call him or something, then with all the pain and everything he would feel. And one night he was sitting on his bed all night, and I said to myself, how is possible for an old man like him, skinny with all this pain, sitting on the bed for hours speaking, I cannot do it. As a young man, I cannot do it. I cannot sit like him and love Baba like that. And then he read my mind and he started repeating Baba's name with such a sweet melody and with a tone, and he tried to tell me, even you cannot love like that, you can repeat Baba's name. And I started repeating Baba's name, and he stopped crying. And then it was the last day, it was 4 o'clock, I was in the kitchen preparing something. And the radio was on, and the Muslim was time for prayer, and Muslim was singing a song.
that time in Esfandiar, that time. And even he said, he told me before that, I said, I will see you again. He said, no, I won't see you again. And at that time, he dropped his body, and they took him to the Zoroastrian cemetery in actually the Tower of Silence, that Shahryar worked there, yes, in Khorasan. Now it's a museum, kind of. Well, the story called the place, they don't use it, but the Zoroastrian cemetery is there. They took his body for a baptism, for washing, and the man who was in charge for washing his body, he asked me to come and help. I said, okay, I'll come. I went there, and then when I saw him, the thought came to my mind, what he said once, where I was trying to help him to have a bath. He said, human needs once, twice washing, twice, two times back in their life. One when they're born, one they die. And then I said, okay, this is the last time I give him back. And then I helped the other person to wash his body. You know? But, and then what I tried to say, and then I met Baum Kulturi later on, and also Marwan Jasawala. Those, there are great people that Baba brought in our life, see how we can love him, we can be like him, and try to serve him and love him. The Spaniard was indifferent. Baoji was most universal. I would say when I met Baoji, he changed my name and he called everyone queen and king and this and that. And he said, you can write, you can translate, you can do poetry and all that. I said, I cannot do it. But he said, don't say no. And when I was with Baba, so Baba said, you know, writing and poetry and translating. I said, same thing to Baba, and Baba said, never say no to me. Whatever I ask you to do, you do it. It took me a long time to realize what Baoji was telling me. Baoji told me that he changed my mind, and I realized this identity that I have, family gave me, and it's not true. I'm not Shaheen. I born as a soul in this body. I came from the ocean of the infinite power of bliss and knowledge. And I came to this body to realize who I am. And I could be a king, I could be a queen, I could be anyone, I could be a bear, I could be anyone in any next life, whatever. So the mind, our mind, when I raise all the information that I collect from the family and peoples and all that, is all collected in my memory, that I am not the mind, I am soul. And Esfandiar also said, this was his meditation, and he told me, sit in a quiet place and tell to yourself, I am not this body, I am not this feeling, but emotional, I am not this energy, I am not mind, I am soul. And I love Meher Baba in my heart or in my heart. He told to many, and all the people he knew his also. Most of the people they came to him. That was his lesson to tell him to love, to Baba taught his family on how to love him. Baba said, you cannot love me with your mind. Mind cannot love with God, only heart. Your heart can love me and Baba. Baba is there. And you will see him and you will find him in your heart.
Thank you.
Thank
you. Thank you. Thank you. And I think for us, we just one more quote from Esfandiar.
I missed the 1963 story, but I guess we don't know what to do. I could try in 10 minutes if I.
Do you want to hear the 1963 story? Okay, because Esfandiar did come back.
We talked about the beginning, talked about the end. But 1963, actually, Esfandiar had so much longing to go see Baba. Actually, Baba came to Iran in 1931, went to their house, and that has a lot of stories behind that. But Baba promised him that he will see him again. So in 19, and then between then and 1931 also, there are a lot of stories. We won't have time for all those stories. But 1963, actually 62, Baba calls for the East West Lebanon. So a lot of people from East Lebanon, they go to see Baba. And it's time they wanted to go, but they did not have money. So, Daigo writes to Esfandiar what Baba says. Because Esfandiar writes to Baba, but Baba, I want to come and see you, but I don't have any money. And Daigo writes to him, as Baba had instructed, to ask him what he's doing and, you know, what his work was. And he said, you know, I have a small little orchard, some cherry trees, sometimes I plant some, you know, I have some strawberries, sometimes I make money off of the strawberries and cherries. A lot of times the blossoms, you know, they burn and they're not good and I don't get any fruits. So Baba writes back that Baba says, go to every cherry tree and say that I want to go see Mary Baba, and you are obligated to give me a lot of cherries this year so I can spend the money to go see Mary Baba. And literally he goes, by Baba's instruction, stands in front of every tree and says, this is what Mary Baba says, you know, you have to give me a lot of cherries so I can sell and go see Mary Baba. Some time passes and, you know, he couldn't go in 62, but right in the spring of 63, he sees Garson, you know, the blossoms, so much blossoms on the cherry trees. And he knew that the world of the avatar is not gonna, you know, it's gonna be basically happening. It's not gonna be ignored by the trees. He borrows money, goes and spends 27 days with Baba, and that has a long story also. But then he comes back, because he knew that the trees will improve. And he comes back and sees that the cherry trees are loaded, and he starts, you know, basically picking them up. There was a fellow who was trucking them to the market and sending them, ordering them, giving them the money. And the truck driver asks him, Esfandiar, where are you bringing all these cherries? He says, from these trees. He says, only these few trees? He says, yes. He says, no matter how much we pick, the cherries are just not the trees. He only covered me, he said, I pay off my debt to go see them. Also, I have enough money for the whole year. And then also he gave cherries, not a handful, but a box of cherries to every volunteer. And I remember the box came to our house, yes. We enjoyed those cherries too. So that is really what the avatar does. He wants to do it. So that was in 1963. And he said he had a great time, you know, being with Baba. Actually, when he came, he wanted to go on land, but the bridge had washed away by the flood. So he basically had to get a flight ticket. So he flies to Bombay and from there the train to see Baba. Baba had 4 days of visiting but he spends 27 days there. He's in the Bhagavad says, you stay in the Mandalay, be here and eat a little bit of Mandalays, but go back and check on your ticket. Because he had to get a ticket to descend from Iran with the Iranian money. He didn't know that. So he basically contacts his son to get his ticket and all that, but as he was leaving Baba after 4 days, all of a sudden he says, Esfandiar, don't go without letting us know. So when he goes to Bombay again, he arranges for the ticket and all that, they say, yeah, it's going to take another week or so. And then he comes back because of what Alava said. And Alava said, why did you come back here? You know, he says, you told me, basically to say, to not let, you know, not go without letting me back here. So he said, okay, okay. And then he goes back to Baba and I said, yeah, you know. He goes to, stays with Baba again, and one more time he goes to Bombay again, and again he comes back. So finally Baba says, you stay to the last minute, but make sure you do this for a bit. And then he goes back to Iran and, you know, starts to celebrate the charity. It's crazy. Yes, sir.
I was just wanted to ask you a question. When Esfandiar was assaulted by all these thoughts, I'm assuming these are thoughts that he didn't have before, or they were thoughts that he might have had, they were just more intense. And because he knew that Baba knew he was having these thoughts, or because they might have been thoughts he never had before, was he not able to disidentify those thoughts?
You know, that is the time of the Pramaksham, that these thoughts were bombarding and overwhelming, and he couldn't control them. Baba had said, let the thoughts go and basically think of me and love me. But the thoughts were so bad, the thoughts were bad thoughts about Baba, his family and all that, and he said, I could not eat here, eat Baba's food, and dress Baba's clothing, and all that. And then think bad and hear about him, and you know, all the wonderful and relatives and all that. He said, I'd rather to die than, you know, these thoughts come to me. And then Baba finds out about these thoughts and takes him to the back hall of the museum. And then starts telling him, okay, tell me about your thoughts. And Sandra says, what are you thinking, Sandra? Tell me. He says, nothing, brother, nothing, brother. And then he says, no, tell me. He says, nothing, brother. Then this Baba starts spelling out in character on the alphabet board all every single thoughts that he was thinking. And then he says, now, do you understand this? And the Sandra said, at that time, I wanted the ground to open his mouth and swallow him. I was so ashamed of myself and his thoughts. And then Baba walks away. But he said, Baba, at that time, after that, he helped me to the extent that I could have 100% control of my thoughts. He said, it was like me being in the house, and somebody knocks at the door, which were the thoughts. You could either open the door and let them in, or you could ignore it. So the thoughts are like that. They would bang on it, and it's basically mental, you know, brain and all that, but you wouldn't let them come in.
Yes, let me just say this for 1 second. Baba said, you understand. I'm assuming Baba is saying, you're not responsible for these thoughts. Do you understand this? And it's one thing for the thoughts not to be let in, but if the thoughts are let in and you don't identify with them, you don't suffer as much as if you feel responsible for the thoughts and you identify with them.
That's right. Baba explains that later, but what he mentioned to the Paramahansa Bose at the time was basically, from what I heard from the Sandra, was that you control your thoughts and you bring all your thoughts and focus on me. And that was bothering him because he couldn't focus on Baba. and all of these thoughts would come instead. So that's why, you know, Prabhupada's why the person is to basically bring these thoughts up and clean them up for you. But he was stubborn enough not to say, because he was ashamed. But Prabhupada spells out the thoughts for him, so he cleanses up. This is what he said. Because he said, after that, no bad thoughts. You could control them.
Any more questions?
Yeah. Is there any outstanding story that Esfandiar told? Any outstanding or memorable story that Esfandiar spoke about the time that Baba was there with them in Iran? In
yes.
31?
Yes, you know, quite a few, but one of them I can say it was that when Baba comes to Jaffarabad, you know that his house is and David's house is, and his father, although Esfandiar had come to the Ashram back, didn't really believe in Baba. And when Baba comes, they bring Baba in the jeep because there's so much sand there. So anyway, Baba gets up, he takes his shoes and puts it under his armpit and starts walking, you know, walking, and you know, Baba was walking in those days, and the mandal is running, and his father was standing looking at Baba and said, "Why?" When he saw Baba, this is his father's telling him after Baba left. And he said, "When I saw Baba, before I saw Baba, it was like me being chained. You know, I was bound, being chained. But then when I saw Baba, it was like the chain was broken. I felt so free. And his movement made me free of everything." And then Baba basically comes to their house. His mother has prepared a pillow. She had put it on the shelf, not letting anyone to touch it or use it, because she had made it with the intention that if Baba comes and when Baba comes, she would put it there so Baba can sit on it. And she had put that pillow right on the veranda the day of Baba comes, and Baba comes and goes right into the house, sits on the pillow for a few minutes, and then comes in.
Anyone else? I just have this one last quote from Esfandiar. He says, "The internal experiences that I have achieved from Baba were simply this, that only to love Baba was true. No other than loving him, no amount of meditation or asceticism had any value. When my inside is completely empty of everything else, and when I completely love Baba, only when I feel myself to be Baba, I cannot experience anything else.
Can I add one more thing at the end, because I remember we have emphasized on that, and I thought it's going to be helpful for all of us who want to love Baba more and more, because Baba says, "Love me more and more and more and more until I am no more of this material." Worthy of any religion. Now, how do we love him more and more? The Sanger says, the Pramashram boys at this practice, the Baba told them, "You image me." First, he told us, "You image me within the third eye." Now, you see a picture of Baba. For them, Baba was there, so they would image him physically. But for us, he said the best is, you know, the picture of Baba that we love the most, you focus on that picture. You image him within your third eye, And then she got there, while the star first repeating his name and then love him. Let that flow of love come through you. And at later years, he said that now you bring that image within your veil. Basically, now it's not in your mind anymore, you bring it at the center of your body. And you basically focus on him, on that image, and you love him. And you let that flow of love, that flow of love is the main thing that you need to keep going. And as you love him, and this love intensifies, you take him to the beginning, you need to go. And sometimes I'm asking, how would we know basically where we are and where the destination is? And sometimes you give an example of this couple of our friends. And just not only as commands as the other ones, so put it out. I'm not going to ask a body to arrest him. And what that says is that no one knows where the destination is or where the beloved is. This much I can tell you, that the realm of the world comes. And that's the second realm of consciousness that I was describing. That, you know, the realm of the world comes all the time. You hear the melodies within, and the sights, light, and, beauty of God, basically, the divine fragrance and the divine attributes of God slowly comes into you until it bears all the karma and samsaras. Those are the signs that will keep you moving through. Now, once I ask him, what's the difference between a must, and someone who is going through your path consciously, says the must, they get stuck between the two planes, and they cannot progress. They get attracted to an attribute of God. Maybe the sight, maybe the melodies. They just enjoy it. For years and years, they can sit there and enjoy it. And they think that they wish to go, but they're lost, they get stuck in that. But he said, if your focal point is Baba, and this image and attributes within you is going to put you through all this. Any problem with getting stuck. So I just wanted to share that with you, and that was the last things that he was telling me. And he made it very simplified in a few words. In your realm, with your realm. Within your realm, you image, and with your realm, you know.
Also, want to add one point of Hafiz for the deal. And Hafiz says, Cheshmigil Bahas Kun Kitabini Anjinali Danas Anbi. Open up the eyes of your heart or deal, and you will see whatever is not visible. And the deal also, my expression is a mental body. That when the eyes of the mental body open, you will see God. You can see God's love Baba in your heart.
Jai
Baba.